All decisions about the future are based on models. This might mean a mathematical complex tool that is used to derive a decision of some kind, or it might mean just a mental model that you use to decide whether you have time to stop for a coffee on your way to work, or whether you'll be late if you do that. Models, however, are also simplified versions of reality, which is much more complex, and they won't capture everything. So for example, did your model consider that there might be a queue at the cafe, or the probability that the coffee machine is broken? Probably it did not. Similarly, the very complex models do not capture everything, but what does this mean for the use of them? My presentation will focus on a specific set of models that are used for long-term energy systems analysis. Energy system is responsible for a bulk of greenhouse gas emissions around the world, and therefore it's also at the center of the mitigation activities that are planned. The energy system, however, is also highly complex. It has several different components that interact with each other, which means that when you change one part of the system, the rest of the system will change as well. There's also high uncertainties related to how the technologies will develop going forward, which technologies will reduce in costs, how people's behavior will change. This creates additional complexities and uncertainties for decisions today. Similarly, if one knows where one wants to be in the long term, for example, reaching net zero targets or so, it's difficult to tell what exactly one would need to do today in order to reach that target. Due to these complexities and difficulties, energy system models dominate the quantitative analysis of long-term energy system development. What then are energy system models? Well, firstly, they're mathematical representations of the system, basically a bunch of equations that describe the relationships of different components of the system. The models differ in their focus and the rationale that underlies them. So for example, one model might focus on technological detail, whereas another one might focus more on the economics of the energy system. Similarly, some models might describe the cost-effective pathways for reaching specific targets, whereas others might be more descriptive and try to mimic the behavior of the energy system and how it might react to specific policy instruments, for example. The one common theme between all the models, no matter the focus and the type, is that they stand in for the actual real-world energy system, because it's very difficult to do experiments with the actual real-world energy system, certainly over decades. So there are virtual laboratories that one can use in order to hopefully gain insights about how the real world might function if, for example, a specific climate target is imposed. These models are highly influential. They're used a lot in international and national policy making across countries and international bodies like the IPCC, from which this specific figure is from. The central role has, however, also attracted some critiques because the models are responsible for so much of the widely accepted conclusions and different narratives about how the energy system development will help reach the climate goals. These critiques highlight the fact that the models are imperfect and they are based on specific type of rationales that might not reflect all the details of the real world. I've spent my career building and using such models, but during recent years I've paid more and more attention also to how the models are used, how they're interpreted, how they're communicated to the non-model users of the results. In the remainder of this presentation, I will focus on a research that we recently completed that focused on reviewing such critiques emerging from outside the modeling community, trying to understand what items are seen as especially problematic. And I will discuss some of them here during the rest of the presentation. The first item is transparency and the role of the modeler. Here, the key issue is that the models are very large, they have volumes of data, and they are complex. So this means that for someone who's not an expert in the use of the model and who has access to the model, it's very difficult to understand what's driving the results that come out of the model, what kind of assumptions have been made in order to produce the results that are then shown, for example, to the policymakers. What's more, even if the data was available, if all the inputs for the model were available for an end user, one still wouldn't know how a specific assumption was derived. Since the models are modeling the future, none of the data points in it is actual data, they're all assumptions. So how was a specific assumption derived? What kind of thought process was behind choosing one value against another? This is practically never documented, and there may well be value judgments behind the numbers. Also, access to the model is limited, and even when it's available, the problem is that being able to operate such a model and understanding how it functions requires special expertise that isn't widely distributed. So even when the modelers try to be transparent, it doesn't necessarily lead to transparency. Scenario choice and the role of stakeholder was another item that emerged from the review strongly. This is more about the specific exercises that one does with the models. What kind of questions does one try to answer, and who gets to define the questions? In addition to the academic community, the main consumer of the results are the policymakers. So those who are already in power and have a powerful position and can drive their own agenda and so on. And this is also shown in the model results, which often emphasize costs, technologies, and so on, for example, much more than issues that might be important to other type of stakeholders, so distributional impacts, energy poverty, and things like that. So the problem, in a way, is that the modelers need to be relevant for the policymakers, because the models are essentially analyzing policy issues. But at the same time, the analysis should be legitimate in the sense that it's speaking to a broad range of interest and not focusing only a very narrow group. There's another issue, which is about credibility, which is, of course, that if the modeling community is seen to be too close to the policymaker, there's a concern that they are just repeating the messages of the powerful and filtering them through the models. Third item is interpretation of model results. The modelers often describe themselves as map makers who are exploring the possibility space, where the logic is that the models are not trying to forecast a specific future and not necessarily even say what would be the implications of a specific policy, but they are trying to map the range of different development paths that the energy system might take. However, as this map here is just showing Northern Europe and not Southern Europe, the possibility space is never really complete, but it's focused on the type of exercises that the modeling community decides to conduct, which, as we just discussed, is not equally distributed. So that's one item one problem in terms of what the kind of full portfolio of the model results might mean. Another issue is that map is not the territory. So the model is still an imperfect, simplified description of the actual system. And there are great uncertainties in the development of the actual system, which in the models is described through discrete scenarios. So there's ambiguity. What do the model results mean in terms of mapping those to real-world developments, real-world actions? And this has been an issue since the 80s, at least, that it's an ongoing unsolved problem, that how can one link the actual results to the real world? And it's unlikely to be solved anytime soon, which makes it even more important that the modeling team should focus more on giving guidance how the results should be interpreted or how they should not be interpreted, and communicate this clearly to the final user. So what to conclude? I would argue that having a map of some kind is always better than not having map at all, even if the map is imperfect. Transparency has been an issue that's been coming more and more to the front for years. It's also the funders are emphasizing it much more, and the community has also responded. So there's much more models freely available for anyone who would like to have one, and the data is being made available. Hurdles remain, especially the ones that I already mentioned, which is that the sheer volume of the data, the complexity of the models will always create some opaqueness that is very difficult to overcome. in terms of the stakeholders who get to define what kind of exercises are being conducted, this has also been recognized by the community, and more and more effort is going into broadening the participation in how the scenarios are defined, what kind of elements do they investigate, and so forth. And more generally, the community is also aware of the problem of the teams focusing on specific type of exercises that are of interest to the policymaker, because the range of scenarios is often also seen as some kind of reflection of uncertainties, and this then gives a false sense of certainty. Finally, the interpretation and communication of the results is, from my view, still a gap. So unlike the two other items, it hasn't necessarily been as clearly put to the front because it's very difficult to solve. And one thing that I think might help, which happens in some other communities, is that there's even a separate stage devoted to interpretation of the results, which then explicitly makes clear what one should take from the results and what not. So to conclude, I think that we all need models. We need models for in our daily lives, the mental models that we use, and we need them for the energy system analysis. But this certainly does not mean that the tools couldn't improve, and I look forward to that happening soon. Thank you.